Hi, welcome to Think Tech, raising public awareness about technology, energy, diversity, and globalism. This show is Center Stage. I'm your guest host, Tony Pasculi, filling in for Donna Blanchard, who's on the mainland again. Donna Blanchard is the proud managing director of Kumu Theater, which is right down the block. We're broadcasting live from Pioneer Plaza in the heart of downtown Chinatown. We're going to be talking today with Jeannie Barroga. She is a playwright and author, and she is in particular the author of the new play Buffaloed at Kumu Theater opening. When is that opening, Jeannie?
Thursday, tomorrow.
Opening tomorrow. That's exciting. Are you ready?
Yes.
Okay.
I am.
Great. Mm-hmm. And this is not the first time you've had this play produced, is that right? It's been done somewhere else previously?
No, this is considered the Hawaiian premiere.
Okay.
It was the world premiere in 2012 at San Jose Stage.
Great.
In California. So
I understand the play is about buffalo soldiers in the Philippines, and that's really all I know. But and you're a history buff, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Pretend I'm completely ignorant of history, and I don't know what a buffalo soldier is. What would you tell me?
I would tell you that the buffalo soldiers were first formed in the Civil War. They were invited to fight for the North against the South for their own freedom, and proved to be such good fighters, they went on to fight in the Indian Wars and in the Caribbean and Spanish-American War and the Philippines and even a little further to the Boxer Rebellion. So the Buffalo Soldiers have quite a history since that time.
And what makes them Buffalo Soldiers?
Two schools of thought. One is that when they fought in the Indian Wars, there were 38 recorded Indian Wars that they fought in, mm-hmm. and the Indians were so impressed with their fighting ability, they named them after their favorite animal, Katanka, which is buffalo.
Hmm. Okay.
And the other school of thought is their woolly hair resembled the buffalo. So I go with the first.
Okay. Great. So how is this production shaping up compared to, I don't want to put you on the spot and make you choose a favorite, but obviously this is going to be a very, Kumu is going to be a very different sort of production than
mm-hmm.
your production on the mainland, I imagine.
Mm-hmm.
So what are some of the differences that you've encountered along the way?
Cast.
Obviously.
But the difference is that it really is a new play. After it closed in 2012, I rewrote it 2 months later.
Oh, wow, okay.
Yeah.
Great.
Because then I just figured there were things I could still tweak.
Mm-hmm.
And as a writer, if you're going to grow and really look at your own work critically,
mm-hmm.
it's like, okay, if I can fix that, I will. And if I get another production, it'll be ready. So I set myself up that way in the anticipation that I'm going to make it the best possible product I can.
Okay, great.
Mm-hmm.
Any other differences? I imagine that Kumu, I don't know this, but I imagine Kumu is a smaller, more intimate venue than your previous
mm-hmm.
venue. Yeah.
Well, actually, it's almost about the same seating.
Oh, really? Okay.
But San Jose Stage was an equity house.
That
so
makes a difference.
That was the yeah. biggest difference.
So
right
now
there.
You're working with much more passionate people. Who
passionate
are not getting paid.
People who are doubling, tripling, quadrupling roles, which are amazing that they can get that much done
mm-hmm.
in the amount of time that they were given. So yeah. Mm-hmm.
How involved are you as the playwright with the production? Are you kind of hands on? Does the director allow you into the room?
The director, Reb, has been very, very good about allowing me into the room.
Mm-hmm.
But we had been in conversation by telephone for at least a couple months before I came out.
Mm-hmm.
And that established the groundwork for our working relationship. So once I came into town, which was earlier in January, I started sitting in on some of the rehearsals, and we would have our talks afterwards. And then I'd go away for a couple of days and come back and see what else had been done and comment on that. And as it got closer to opening, which is tomorrow,
mm-hmm.
the amount of involvement just sort of lessened and lessened, and now it's on them.
They're
be wonderful to see what they'll show me and everybody on opening night tomorrow.
Any surprises for you in this production?
Surprises.
Yeah. Mm. Anything that you just like, oh, that's an interpretation that hadn't occurred to me before. That's
oh
new...
yeah, yeah, yeah.
Hmm.
But I kind of hesitate telling about it because it's so wonderful. It's a monologue.
No spoilers. No spoilers. I'm just.
It's a monologue that turned into something very, very creative and theatrical.
Okay.
And it was a whole different view of how to even handle that compared to San Jose Stage Surgeon. So I really was pleased with it, yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's one of the things I love about live theater is that it's, mm-hmm. it's, you know, it's unique and it's ephemeral. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You can't really see the same play twice, even if you, you know, same playwright, same play. Yeah. Well, you said even the play script is different.
Yeah.
But just, you know, coming to it with a new cast and a new director and a new venue just changes everything.
Oh, so. Yeah, and coming into town and also having a different script. So by the time it shows tomorrow, I would say it's maybe another 5% change since wow. they first got the script.
How mm-hmm. long have you been in town to support the production?
I arrived January 5th.
Is this your first trip to Hawaii? Oh, excuse me, I lost my thing. Is this your first trip to Hawaii?
No, I've been here about a dozen times.
Oh, yeah. Great, okay. Mm-hmm. So is there something about this play that you think is particularly relevant to Hawaii?
I think in general, it's a viewpoint of where the U.S. really became an imperialist country and how that affected not only the Philippines, but pretty much all the islands across the Pacific between the U.S. and China. And that to me really was a point I wanted to make a bigger emphasis over with this production, because the takeover was it preceded the Philippines at least by 6 years. So there was already that school of thought about, you know, they're coming this way and they're starting to take over this and own that and beware of it. And it kind of gave a heads up to the American public too about, what are you doing? This is not even a little over 30 years since the Civil War. Why can't you take care of things at home? Mm-hmm. And why do we need to go over there and take over countries and essentially use people who we have no connection with or we don't know about, and yet we're trying to change their culture? Mm-hmm. So across the board, yeah, anything that was along that path, any island, any territory, but particularly Hawaii. And I did adapt that in my PowerPoint presentations that I was giving at the local colleges, Windward, Leeward, okay, UH, yeah. Manoa. So I wanted to make sure that was something the local audiences would be able to identify with.
Okay, mm-hmm. That's great. And then just to be clear, that is supporting material that you did for the colleges. That's sort of a lecture, that's the history, that's the background. But the play itself is not a history lesson. It's a dramatization. It's still a very human story.
It's very theatrical. Okay. And there's the Eskrima arts, martial arts that the actors had to learn.
Really?
And also be able to morph it really into dances, because that's what happened in that war. They were not allowed to congregate. So they would have their meetings and their dances and disguise the moves. I just really think it was something that would add to the theatricality of it. Yeah. There is an original song by the playwright. There's other songs of the period. Mm-hmm. I see it as a full theatrical experience.
Great. Mm-hmm. Now I had another question for you, and it slipped my mind while we were talking about that. So, mm-hmm. What was it that brought this play to Kumu? Was that you? Was that Kumu? Did you submit it as part of the playwriting contest or something else? Or
When it was in production in San Jose, mm-hmm. I really thought, you know what, this would be nice to see if theaters that I'd worked with before would be interested again. I always resubmit to theaters I've worked with before.
And Kumu Kuhua. You did a talk story at Kumu.
In 1995.
That's a while ago. Yeah.
So I had been in touch with Harry, and I was kind of sending him draft after draft after draft, till finally I said, this is it. This is the one it would really be nice to be able to even have a reading of, you know, just kind of get my foot in the door again. And in summer of 2016, he finally contacted me, and he said, we're interested in doing it. I was like, yes.
So. And so you brought this play to Kumu, but I'm sure, because you're connected with, the Asian American Theater Company, that's in San Francisco?
That's San Francisco, yeah.
Okay, mm-hmm. So you must have done other plays that tie into the Hawaii experience in some way, the Asian community in some way. Why this play at this time?
Why this play at this time? Yeah. At the time when I was influenced and inspired to write it, we were in a state of being aware of the Gulf War soldiers.
Okay.
having a very, very, very hard time over there. They don't talk about the desertion rates, really, but it was something that was becoming more and more of an issue. Mm-hmm. And so when I came across the story about the Buffalo Soldiers, I figured, okay, there's something that probably could connect people today, modern audiences, with what already had happened back then. It's a repeat of history that shouldn't have to happen. Mm-hmm. That's kind of one of the issues I was making a point about. So yeah, it's always, my plays are always meant to connect something going on currently, mm-hmm. and without hitting people over the head. It's just like, look at this story, you know? Relook at history as you've been taught, mm-hmm. or not taught, and just be aware that there are other ways of thinking about that.
Parallels, resonances, mm-hmm. sure, mm-hmm. okay. Mm-hmm. You've written a lot of plays, say 60 plays, according to your...
That I tell people about. It's really more than that, but I...
Well, you have some trunk plays, I'm sure.
Trunk plays,
sure,
a lot of trunk plays, yeah.
So are there themes in your plays that you keep coming back to?
Yeah, pretty much. Mm-hmm. Identity was a large one for a long time. Connection, which is I see as Buffalo's main theme, really. And again, it's because of all the disparate cultures and peoples that are in America today. I write about an American landscape. I want to see on stage the friends and the people I see on the street that I rub shoulders with. So it needs for me to be that specific, let's
okay.
say.
Yeah.
So even though people say, oh, you write just Filipino plays, not necessarily. I really write to show that there are Filipinos in this fabric that we call the American society. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then there's others.
The people you meet on the street is going to depend on what street you live on.
Right.
For sure. Yeah.
Right.
So
right.
Mm-hmm. Definitely something I experienced moving to Hawaii. Speaking of, so you said you've been out here for how long? A couple weeks?
It's almost about, 3 weeks now.
3 weeks? Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Have you had a chance to do anything fun in the islands besides we've been chained to the theater all the whole time?
Yes.
Okay. You're out here with your husband, Tony, who is watching the show right now.
Yeah, and he arrived a couple days ago. So,
oh, okay.
I had time to kind of just bop around the island and find some little snorkeling areas. And
nice.
I got in touch with an old friend of mine who is the daughter of a band member who was in my dad's band. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to connect that way as well, just because the history of my own family is something very new for me. In the last year, I finally found a lot of things on Ancestry, mm-hmm. and I direct the PowerPoint lecture about to other people who may have that same type of dilemma, like where did I come from? How did I end up here, you know?
Okay. Just to say, we're gonna take a break in just a second. We will be back after about a minute break with Jeannie Barroga. Playwright, her play, Buffaloed, is opening at Kumukahu.
Aloha, I'm Kaui Lucas, host of Hawaii is My Mainland, here on ThinkTech Hawaii every Friday at 3 p.m. We address issues of importance for those of us who live here on the most isolated landmass on the planet. Please come join me Fridays at 3 p.m. Mahalo.
Aloha and haole maka hiki ho, which is Happy New Year, and I hope it's a happy and prosperous new year for you. I'm Kili'i Akina with the Grassroot Institute. Every week we partner with ThinkTech Hawaii and produce a program called Ehana Kako, Let's Work Together. We bring together movers and shakers who are making a difference here in Hawaii, making a better Hawaii for everyone. If you're interested in improving the economy, the government, and society, join us every week on Mondays at 2 o'clock p.m. for Ehana Kako on the ThinkTech Hawaii Broadcast Network. Until you see me then, aloha.
Welcome back to ThinkTech Hawaii. This is Center Stage. This is again Tony Pasculi, guest hosting for Donna Blanchard, who's still on the mainland. And we are talking to Jeannie Barroga, playwright, author, director, actor, backstage helper in theater. You wear all the hats. What are some of the more unusual hats you have worn in the
more
theater?
More unusual.
Sure.
Let's see. Gee, that's hard to say. They're probably early in the career when I was thrown into the booth to work not only the sound and the music cues, and what was the other one? It was like three different things at once. And of course, I had contracted to just do sound. And okay. I said, well, while you're up there in that small little booth, instead sure. of us getting another person in there, but that's not as unusual, really.
No, that's not unusual at
not
all.
At
that
all.
Happens all the
that
time.
That happens, yeah. right. Probably the one thing was when I was the associate artistic director of Asian American Theater, and actors came in from all over for Philip Catanda's play. And so they said, well, would you drive them around? All right. Well, okay, these are Asian American actors that had very specific needs, let's say, and they wanted to go to a very specific restaurant, and so we're driving around, and I'm thinking, like, we got to get back to the theater. This is just a break, you know. And he said, no, you have to eat this place. It's really, really wonderful. So that was kind of unusual there. But also being called upon to drive around a very, very well-known, actually, Hollywood actor.
Okay.
They had her up in a bed and breakfast, which was really nice, except she didn't know anybody for the very, very short weekend run. And so they said, would you take her around? And I said, I have a truck. I'm in theater,
Yeah.
I said, if she doesn't mind being in a truck, fine, So I took her around to Chinatown in San Francisco, and boom, everyone recognized her. So I'm thinking, oh, good. She gets to see people. They get to see her. And in town like that. So it was unusual because I knew it was important for her to be seen, and she was so appreciative after that because she knew that she wasn't going to be able to make her own way around in the short time she was there.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah.
It's always great to have a host. I mean, someone who just really introduces you, not just shows you the places, but connects you to the people in the place. Mm-hmm. That's a wonderful thing, so,
So, and that just taught me a lot, too, about sometimes when you think someone is big, there's a humility that they know that is part of that persona as well, in order to have a fan base that will love them, really, So she was very gracious. It was lovely to spend time with her.
Yeah. We were talking before the show about how when you get involved in theater, you end up doing basically all the jobs. And then you're mostly a playwright now. Is that your favorite job, or is that the one where you just felt like you could just bring the most to bear?
Well, that's the one I put on my tax return, so it's the one that brings in the majority of the money, so.
I'm saying, is that the one you enjoy the most? Is there something?
Yeah.
Oh, it is? Okay, great.
Yeah,
that's always nice.
I mean, it's helpful to get the income coming in, but you also love it, So, because, of course, there were times early on where I didn't get that kind of income. This is like all love, and to the point where you're holding down four other jobs, and you're paying to be in theater. And over time, it changes. And it's so gradual, you don't really notice it because you still love it.
So you're also a director. How is that different from playwriting?
Oh, way different. It's different hats. I keep calling it different hats. When I would talk to my cast about the play that I wrote, and they'll say, I don't quite get this point, blah, 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 blah. I said, let me run that by the playwright, and I'll get back to you. So I just have to be very, very specific when I'm the director and when I'm the playwright,
So you have directed your own work?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
But I have directed other people's work too, which is, it's easier because then you do have that distance to look at their work and be the dramaturg for that as well as the director.
It's easier. I guess it is easier to direct other people's work. But then on the other hand, how do you feel? You're comfortable, at this point you must be, you have to be, you're comfortable having other people direct your work.
I mean,
there's always that sort of risk you take when this is your baby, and you hand it to someone else, and you say, here, please be gentle with this, and they just go, I have an idea for this. I see it as a Busby Berkeley musical. Mm-hmm. And you're like, no, it's not.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, is that, do you ever any horror stories along those lines?
That's pretty drastic.
I'm using hyperbole here.
The probably one of the worst case scenarios was where I really did have to say, no, this is probably not the play for you, you know, and I just pulled it. And that's a big chance because, of course, especially if money has already been exchanged, and it's like, I'll give you your money back. You just, I don't think you're going to do justice to the play.
Okay.
You know, but that's very rare. You know, when you work with a director, like I'm working with Reb right now, and he says, I have ideas. I said, okay, run it by me. And you can still tell you're in sync because the ideas, the presentation is going to change no matter what happens.
Sure.
But as long as it doesn't change the story and the lines, you know, but particularly the thrust of what the play's intent is, what the scene's intent is, to me, I'm probably a lot more flexible than some people because having gone through that route, I know when it works, you know, by a description, it's like, that sounds good, let's try it. But if it doesn't, you know, we just say, you know.
Well, it's really gratifying to hear that you and Reb had been in so much contact beforehand. He's really open to, you know, having you in the room and working with you. And a lot of directors are not like that. They really just want to, you know, it's like, hey, your line, your job ends when you hand me the script.
Right. And I don't know. I mean, that's not, to me, the meaning of collaboration, and that's not the meaning of theater. Because here I am in my little room alone, and I'm typing, and I know it so well. You give it to people, and there are things that are going to be explained. But as a playwright, it's like, if I have to explain that much, it's in the writing. That's something I have to change, you know.
Yeah.
So that's the difference to me. If there's something we collaborate on and we come to that same point, it's like, okay, good, we're on the same page. But if it's just not working on a writer's level, it means I have to go back to the table, you know.
Yeah. And playwriting is sort of, as you were saying before, it's kind of a more fluid art form than some. I mean, I have friends who are novelists, and you put a novel out there, and that's it. You don't you don't get a second bite at the apple, you know. What you printed is what's there forever. And you mentioned that you got you immediately went back to Buffaloed. Oh, I've lost my earpiece again. You immediately went back to Buffaloed and made changes. And is that something that do you often do, or is this a special play for you?
Okay. Pretty much, yeah. No, I don't think there was a play that's ever been produced the first time that I didn't touch again.
Mm-hmm.
Probably one, and that was a one act, but that was because I just worked it, till it finally got to the point where that's it, that's the one I want. Mm-hmm. But I still look at some older plays, and I think, you know, I could tweak that, but it's not that important to, like, have a workshop about it. It's just like when it goes into production, I talked to the director. I said, can you look at this one area for me, or just see how it works in your first reading? And that's enough feedback right there, you know.
Do you ever find yourself in the rehearsal process changing the play?
Like this one?
I'm not suggesting this rehearsal.
No. Sure, but because I have.
Oh, did you?
Oh, yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
wow.
Yeah.
So tell us about that.
Well, okay, there were places in there that, again, because it was a new script, I hadn't seen before, and seeing the actors work a scene, maybe there were too many words, and it's like, okay, let's just see if we can infer that with the action instead, because maybe the action's going to be stronger than these wordy words. And so we did changes along that line. The monologue I was telling you about before, that was another case in point. Talking it over about what is that final moment at the end of the play?
Mm-hmm.
What do you want to really leave the audience with? And so that took a bit of talking through, because it's like, well, we could do this, we could do that. And because I have it in my script already, it's like, I already know I've got to change it because something already is going on that's better. Mm-hmm. So. This is after years and years of having dealt with many directors and learning when that collaboration is just going to blossom or it's just going to, you know, lay flat. And this didn't happen here, you know.
Oh, that's great.
So, yeah.
That's another challenging thing about playwriting is that you, like, as you say, sometimes you find that the action is so clear, and the actors are so expressive, that you can get by with less language, and you can cut it away, you can strip it away in the rehearsal process, but unless that language is there in the first place,
right,
the actors, the director may not necessarily know what the intention was to be able to play it. So, as someone who goes back and forth between playwriting and directing, do you have a strategy for coping with that?
pretty much on a case-by-case basis, you know. Sometimes it could be the acting, you know. Being the writer, I'm always willing to believe that if I can fix it first, yeah. you know, there's only a latitude that an actor or a person creating something can go, because it's so concise. It's like, okay, I get it. I know what the point is, you know, and that means my writing worked. Mm-hmm. So that's how I test myself. You know, it's like if any actor can read the scene and it still mm-hmm. plays, I've done my job, you know, because that's what's going to happen. It's going to be in the mouths of very, very many different types of actors at different experience yeah. levels. And you've got to be as clear as you are as a writer to make sure that it will play no matter what.
That's great. So, mm-hmm. And then you said you're also an actor, so you have some mm-hmm. experience with that too. You know what it is to take a script and find a way to make it work for yourself and mm-hmm. deliver that language. So mm-hmm. is that something you find valuable? I mean, having those different hats, is that being a director and an actor, does that assist you in writing plays?
Yes and no. Okay, I was in a play 2 years ago, and it turned out that playwright was one of my playwriting students. And she liked how I read as we were developing her play. She said, would you audition for this role? Mm-hmm. And I went, I can do that, you know. And so I finally went out for auditions, and the director called me immediately and says, we want to offer you this role. And I went, okay, this will help her, I'm sure, you know. But being in the process, it's not even a but. When we were in the process, I could see already that the changes I had suggested to her while we were developing it still hadn't mm-hmm. been touched. And I said, this is the place and the time to kind of relook at that. Yeah. And at one point she was just really adamant, no, you have to be on stage for this. And I said, but it's not her moment. It's not that character's moment, mm-hmm. you know. And as it turned out, right up until the very end, it was, okay, we'll have to rethink that. But for now, let's just keep it. But so it's that kind of concession yeah. that I kind of almost have to kick myself, because like, I shouldn't say anything, I'm an actor, you know, but they're asking me, if you ask me, I will tell you.
And then she's a student too. I mean, sometimes you have to learn this stuff the hard way by trying it and getting it wrong yeah. and figuring out.
Well, she's actually a very, very good writer. She's been around and published as a poet, but this was her first play. Okay. So that was something that was, that came into play too, because I knew she loved that story, and it worked yeah. for the most part. But it was just, again, theatrically, whose moment is it when you're having yeah. these characters represent something?
Great. Mm-hmm. So again, your play Buffaloed opens tomorrow night at mm-hmm. Kumu Theater, and you're excited about that?
Yes.
And this has been Jeannie Barroga. I'm Tony Pasculi, filling in for Donna Blanchard on Center Stage, ThinkTech Hawaii. Thank you so much. And